For 3 years, out of key with his time, he strove to resuscitate the dead art of poetry, to maintain the sublime in the old sense. Wrong from the start. No, hardly, but seeing he'd been born in a half-savage country, out of date, bent resolutely on wringing lilies from the acorn, caponers, trout for factitious bait. Id men gartoi panthos any troye caught in the unstopped ear, giving the rocks small leeway, and the chopped seas held him therefore that year. His true Penelope was Flaubert. He fished by obstinate isles, observed the elegance of Circe's hair rather than the mottos on sundials. Unaffected by the march of events, he passed from men's memory in l'antrantunième de son âge. The case presents no adjunct to the muse's diadem. The age demanded an image of its accelerated grimace, something for the modern stage, not at any rate an Attic grace. Not certainly the obscure reveries of the inward gaze, better mendacities than the classics in paraphrase. The age demanded chiefly a mold and plaster made with no loss of time, a prose kinema, not assuredly alabaster of the sculptor of rhyme. The tea rose, tea gown, etc., supplants the mousseline of Cos. The pianola replaces Sappho's barbitos. Christ follows Dionysus, phallic and ambrosial made way for macerations. Caliban casts out Ariel. All things are flowing, sage Heraclitus says, but a tawdry cheapness shall outlast our days. Even the Christian beauty defects after Samothrace, we see Tocalon decreed in the marketplace. Fawn's flesh is not to us, nor the saint's vision. We have the press for wafer, franchise for circumcision. All men in law are equals, free if Pisistratus we choose a knave or an eunuch to rule over us. O bright Apollo, Tinandra, Tinaroa, Tinartheon, what god, man, or hero shall I place a tin or wreath upon? These fought in any case, and some believing, pro domo in any case, some quick to arm, some for adventure, some from fear of weakness, some from fear of censure, some for love of slaughter in imagination, learning later, some in fear, learning love of slaughter, died some pro patria, non dolce, non et decor, walked eye deep in hell, believing in old men's lies, then unbelieving, came home, home to a lie, home to many deceits, home to old lies and new infamy, usury age old and age thick, and liars in public places. Daring as never before, wastage as never before, young blood and high blood, fair cheeks and fine bodies, fortitude as never before, frankness as never before, disillusions as never told in the old days, hysterias, trench confessions, laughter out of dead bellies. There died a myriad, and were the best among them, for an old bitch gone in the teeth, for a botched civilization. Charm, smiling at the good mouth, quick eyes gone under earth's lid, for too gross of broken statues, for a few thousand battered books. Gladstone was still respected when John Ruskin produced King's Treasuries, Swinburne and Rossetti still abused. Defeated Buchanan lifted up his voice when that fawn's head of hers became a pastime for painters and adulterers. The Burns-Jones cartons have preserved her eyes. Still at the Tate they teach Cophetua to rhapsodize. Thin like brook water with a vacant gaze. The English Rubaiyat was still born in those days. The thin, clear gaze of the same still darts out fawn-like from the half-ruined face, questing and passive. Poor Jenny's case, bewildered that the world shows no surprise at her last Makarov's adulteries. Among the pickled fetuses and bottled bones engaged in perfecting the catalogue, I found the last sand of the senatorial families of Strasbourg, Monsieur Verog. For 2 hours he talked of Gallifrey, of Dowson, of the Rhymers Club, told me how Johnson, Lionel, died by falling from a high stool in a pub, but showed no trace of alcohol at the autopsy privately performed, tissue preserved. The pure mind arose toward Newman as the whiskey warmed. Dowson found harlots cheaper than hotels, Headlam for uplift, Image impartially imbued with raptures for Bacchus, Terpsichore, and the church. So spoke the author of the Dorian mood, Monsieur Verog, out of step with the decade, detached from his contemporaries, neglected by the young because of these reveries. The sky-like limpid eyes, the circular infant's face, the stiffness from spats to collar never relaxing into grace, the heavy memories of Horeb, Sinai, and the 40 years showed only when the daylight fell level across the face of Brennbaum, the impeccable. In the cream-gilded cabin of his steam yacht, Mr. Nixon advised me kindly to advance with fewer dangers of delay. Consider carefully the fewer. I was as poor as you are when I began. I got, of course, advance on royalties, 50 at first. Mr. Nixon, follow me and take a column, even if you have to work free. Butter reviewers, from 50 to 300 I rose in 18 months. The hardest nut I had to crack was Dr. Dundas. I never mentioned a man without the view of selling my own works. The tip's a good one, and as for literature, it gives no man a sinecure. And no one knows at sight a masterpiece, and give up verse, my boy, there's nothing in it. Likewise, a friend of Blurham's once advised me, don't kick against the pricks, accept opinion. The 90s tried your game and died, and there's nothing in it. Beneath the sagging roof, the stylist has taken shelter, unpaid, uncelebrated. At last, from the world's welter, nature receives him. With a placid and uneducated mistress, he exercises his talents, and the soil meets his distress. The haven from sophistications and contentions leaks through its thatch. He offers succulent cooking. The door has a creaking latch. Conservatrix of Milesian habits of mind and feeling? Possibly, but in Ealing with the most bank-clerkly of Englishmen? No, Milesian is an exaggeration. No instinct has survived in her older than those her grandmother told her would fit her station. Daphne, with her thighs in bark, stretches toward me her leafy hands, subjectively. In the stuffed satin drawing room, I await the Lady Valentine's commands. Knowing my coat has never been of precisely the fashion to stimulate in her a durable passion, doubtful somewhat of the value of well-gowned approbation of literary effort, But never the Lady Valentine's vocation, poetry, a border of ideas, the edge uncertain, but a means of blending with other strata where the lower and higher have ending, a hook to catch the Lady Jane's attention, modulation toward the theater, also in case of a revolution, a possible friend and comforter. Conduct, on the other hand, the soul, which the highest cultures have nourished to Fleet Street, where Dr. Johnson flourished. Beside this thoroughfare, the sale of half hose has long since superseded the cultivation of Pierian roses.
What thou lovest well remains, the rest is dross. What thou lovest well shall not be reft from thee. What thou lovest well is thy true heritage, whose world, or mine, or theirs, or is it of none? First came the scene, then thus the palpable Elysium, though it were in the halls of hell. What thou lovest well is thy true heritage. What thou lovest well shall not be reft from thee. The ant's a centaur in his dragon world. Pull down thy vanity. It is not man made courage, or made order, or made grace. Pull down thy vanity, I say, pull down. Learn of the green world what shall be thy place in scaled invention or true artistry. Pull down thy vanity, Pacan, pull down. The green cask has outdone your arrogance. Master thyself, then others shall thee bear. Pull down thy vanity. Thou art a beaten dog beneath the hail, a swollen magpie and a fitful sun, half black, half white, nor knowest thou wing from tail. Pull down thy vanity. How mean thy hates fostered in falsity. Pull down thy vanity, wraith to destroy, niggard in charity. Pull down thy vanity, I say, pull down. But to have done instead of not doing, this is not vanity. To have with decency knocked that a blunt should open, to have gathered from the air of live tradition, or from a fine old eye the unconquered flame, this is not vanity. Here error is all not done, all in the diffidence that faltered.